You too, though.
Yeah, but with messages, too.
Okay, we're live. Hey, guys, and welcome to Level Up Session 27 with Betty Jiang. Hi, Betty. Welcome, and thanks for joining us.
You're welcome. I'm glad to be here.
Yep. Darek is not with us today because he's busy doing, I don't know what, Polish stuff.
Yeah, probably. We lost him.
We are here with me and Betty and Wojtek. There he is.
Hey, guys.
So, let's start by talking a little bit about our guest.
Oh, is that me?
Yeah, that's you. You're the guest.
Geez. Where do I start?
So, maybe just tell the people a bit about what you do and where you work and blah, 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 all that. Jazz.
Okay, well, I currently reside in Canada, and I work full-time as a contract artist for this company in San Francisco called Spin Punch. They specialize in Facebook games and app games. And, I think it's fair to say that I'm relatively new to the industry because I've only been working for 8 months.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're working from Canada as a freelancer, right? So you freelance work, basically. Okay. Well, that's good. That's a good start. I mean, for someone who's not been doing it for a long time, if you can freelance, it's a luxury already, I guess.
Yeah.
You're doing it right.
I have a lot of, I don't know. I think I've just been really lucky these past few months because, like all my friends seem to, like, give me the connections, and that's how I mostly got all my jobs.
Okay.
I don't think it's being lucky. I think your work is just that good. I mean, I remember finding your work. I think that the first thing I saw from you were these sketchbook drawings and paintings, and I was really impressed by how good you are with, like, traditional media, but then it all translates to digital, and it seems to be the same kind of a vibe, the same kind of a style, and that's what I really like about your work. So that's how I found you. I think it was Facebook still, so yeah, happy to have you here.
Great to be here. So, what else?
Okay, so guys, so if you have any questions for Betty, type them in the chat on the right hand side and prefix them with question in caps, please, so that we can see them, and then we will ask them to Betty during the session. And there's actually already questions coming in.
Yeah.
I want to know how old you are.
Oh, I'm 21.
Okay, so.
Yeah, 92, right?
Yep.
Yeah, me too. Awesome.
Well, I'm so old.
Yeah, youngsters.
Yeah.
So, Jonas is the oldest guy in here today.
Yeah. When I was 21, I was doing other stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know. What
living, for example, right?
Huh? But, living?
Yeah, living.
Yeah, somewhere under a bridge.
And then you found the stylus, right?
Okay, so Betty's going to do a demo for us today. And I got a bunch of messages from people who want to see more of her character stuff. If you haven't seen Betty's work, go check out her website. And that is...
The link is in the description of this video, so you can easily just click more under the video, and it will roll down, and there you go with the link. It will be, so this is just a portfolio on Carbon Made.
Yeah,
let's redirect to ArtStation.
Yeah, so Betty's ArtStation website.
Also Carbon Made, that's fine. They actually can find more stuff on Carbon Made, I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So check out her Carbon Made, which is in the description, or check out her ArtStation, which is... If you can look for Betty inside, or you can go to artstation.com/artist/kawaii Betty.
So professional.
How very Japanese of you. Yeah, cool. I mean, the stuff is just beautiful. I'm just going to share the screen for a minute and show people some of your work. So, doot, doot, doot. So I notice you have really a really nice and unique style of rendering characters and rendering faces. I think It's like perfect character art for games. I think that's probably why you had a hard time.
Oh, that's so nice. I don't know. I don't hear that a lot. A lot of my friends, like, I don't know. Most of my friends who are in concept art, they're just like, oh yeah, we can't really tell your work apart from anybody else's. You guys just all look the same. I'm just like, what? So hurt. But I don't know. It's good to hear that I'm unique in some ways and I stand out.
But, yeah, I mean, it's about compromising. In a way, you have to be unique and refreshing, but in a way, you can't alienate too much from what's expected from concept art if you want to find a job, you know. I mean, in your personal stuff, you can do as much as you want, but, you know, it's an industry and it's a niche, so you sort of have to follow certain things. And it's really, you know, the things that we're looking at now, these are designs, so it's just important to see what the character looks like. Yes, really cool.
Thank you.
So yeah, guys, check out Betty's work. And follow her on Facebook. I don't know, do you allow followers on Facebook or?
Yeah, that's cool. As long as they message me first, so I don't know. Like, I don't know. Like, I'm really careful about Facebook right now because the more followers you have, the more weird messages you get. So they just like
precautions. Yeah.
Yeah, we men don't have that problem.
You just get weird messages sometimes, so you have to be really careful.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, yeah.
You get that all the time, Jonas.
Sorry?
I'm sure you get that all the time, creepy messages.
No, I'm actually the one sending creepy messages to other
people. Oh, so it was you who sent me the dick pictures.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Or Darek,
yeah. Who knows? Okay, so if you are ready, Betty, we can share your screen and we can jump into Photoshop and start looking at some magic.
Ooh, oh my god. Okay. Can you see my screen?
Yeah.
Zoom in, zoom out.
Yep.
So what I have today is actually a redesign of one of my favorite characters from League of Legends, Ashe.
Okay.
I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with the game, but it's pretty popular right now. But basically, she is a Frost Archer. I'm not sure if I can show you this is only a partial of it, because the actual original file is really big. And when I have it on Photoshop, it just lags like crazy, so.
Okay.
I can't risk it, but if anything, I will just send it to you guys later so you can see the actual whole body size of like this character I'm doing. I don't know. So far, I have like a mixture of elements of painted areas and photo bash areas. I don't know. Like, I find that when I'm experimenting with like designs, photo bashing is like, I don't know. It's like much more fun, cause like you make a little happy accident sometimes. You're like, oh, like, you know, this goes with this, and then you make like an interesting form. It's like an interesting way to explore shapes and design.
So is it the way you regularly work with your design? So basically, how do you start that kind of a design, the same style like we just have seen in your portfolio? Is this the same approach?
Basically, because like, actually, when I work, there's actually more pictures involved, but I think the most important thing that people need to remember when using photo, it's like, it's not just photos, it's actually 50-50. Because, like, if you just use photos, it's going to look, like, the photos is only going to do so much for you.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you know, the mood and overall lighting, it's going to really depend on you. So, yeah.
So, to me, it looks like, from what I'm seeing now, it reminds me a little bit of some stuff that I've seen Wojtek doing, where you're basically like pasting in elements first to see if they're in the right position, and you're only going to do rendering and shading to sort of tie it all together after that. Is that correct?
Yeah, basically. You're dead on.
So you're actually exploring the design in this way before you start rendering the final picture?
Yeah, that's usually what I do.
Okay.
Yeah, so this is how you like allow happy accidents to happen. You basically, I don't know, you can just cut the shape off and fill it in with a photo and then see what happens, or you can do all sorts of things with photos, and it's really production friendly because it's fast. So it's much more faster than painting it from scratch. But I guess with your style, you are getting rid of photoiness totally, right? You're overpainting it until it looks consistent from what I've seen. Is it correct?
Yeah, that's what I do.
Yeah.
Which is why I always get messages like, oh, do you do 3D? I'm just like, no, I don't know how to do 3D at all.
Yeah, so can you tell us a little bit more about how do you start with that approach? So do you have like a photo base plate that you start off, or
this is actually like a really low, hang on, I have like all my layers saved. This is actually like a really rough sketch I did. Let me just get rid of all my layers. This is like, yeah, basically this is like the foundation and everything, like a rough line art and like simple colors.
Okay.
And then I just eventually add the lighting. Oh my god, that's a drastic change. But you get the point. It's like a lot of rendering, a lot of hard work.
Yeah, so basically the foundation of every piece is still a drawing or a line sketch, but you're only using photos to add detail or texture or stuff like that. It's not... You don't really start from a photo, like pose-wise.
For this piece, not necessarily. But for others, I have started from pictures before.
Okay.
Yeah. But like I said, like, you know, 50-50, half painted, half photos.
Yeah.
Yes, I should start painting.
Are you comfortable talking and painting at the same time?
Yeah, as long as I know what topic I should talk about.
Okay. Well, we have quite a few questions already, so...
Yay.
If
awesome. Woo Blair.
Let's start with... Okay, so Jay Carpenter has a question for you. Given creative freedom, is there a particular direction you would like to take or develop your art towards, such as illustration or more conceptual pieces?
Oh, God.
Is that too hard?
Wow, that is... I feel like that is like more than just one question stuck into one sentence. Are you going to repeat that again?
Yes. Given creative freedom... Is there a particular direction you would like to take or develop your art towards? It's basically like if there's a direction with your art that you would really like to go with. Are you more into concept art, or would you like to go more towards illustration?
To be honest, I always want to do concept art, but lately I've been told I should be going to illustration, so right now I'm a little bit conflicted. But I think at the end of the day, I still want to do concept art. That is more what I'm...
What?
There's a dog in your house, Betty.
No, it's my house. Sorry, there's
no
dog. Like, give me one moment.
Okay.
Yeah, we always have weird sounds coming from Poland. There's nothing we can do about it.
Of course.
Just have to accept it.
Sorry about that. I killed the dog. Which is fine. I was wondering about the school you are attending. Can you tell us a little bit more about the curriculum, about how much of your time are you spending there and such?
Oh, school?
Yeah, it's cool.
Actually, I dropped out like a while ago.
Oh, okay. You still have, I think.
Do I still have it on my profile?
Yeah. That's why I assume.
Oh, sorry about that. I just never noticed. But
okay. So let's maybe switch the question to something like how that school actually helped you. Is it something significant or?
Well, the reason I'm not in any art school right now is because, like, I don't find particularly any art schools in my region very helpful.
Mm-hmm.
basically I attended two of the biggest art schools in Canada, OCAD and Sheridan, and I attended both for illustration, and I dropped out both of them, so that says a lot about how I feel about schools in Canada. Okay, well, like, I don't want to trash the school or anything, but like, if you want to go into concept art, those are not the things you want to go into.
Yeah, so they provide more of a like traditional approach or just an old school kind of a way of thinking. What do you find really this like not working in these type of schools you have in Canada?
I feel like a lot of the illustration programs, they, or the art programs in general, they focus towards editorial art, okay, which is not my field. And I feel like their general approach to like teaching is just like extremely outdated, and like some of it makes no sense at all. Like, I remember in second year, one of my first projects, I had to like use household objects or like anything I find and make an object out of it. So like I had to take dirt from the ground and like make a silhouette of a chair out of dirt. So you know, that's not exactly very helpful.
But I suppose the schools are actually completely ignorant of the fact that, you know, if you want to make a living with art, you have to go a certain direction. I think schools that do that kind of fine art or experimental art or whatever you want to call it, it's not really designed to make you, you know, end up in an industry like this. It's, you know, they're usually not even aware of its existence. They're that ignorant to it. It's just, you know, the more old school way of thinking about art or being an artist. Which we're not. We're just commercial artists, you know.
Yeah. So, I don't know. Plus, like, a lot of teachers in my school didn't really support my career path. So, like, you know, eventually I just dropped out. Fuck that.
Yeah.
So, how do you seek knowledge right now? I mean, are you trying to train only by yourself? Or do you take any online classes? How do you find that, you know, knowledge you want
to. I haven't really had the time to train. Like,
And that's the best training, probably. You're just working, right?
Yeah, as soon as I dropped out, I just worked. I went back to China and just worked for like a whole summer, and then I came back and I found a job in Canada. And yeah, I don't know. I don't really have time to learn. I just work.
But you're learning as you work.
Yeah, but like, you know, I feel like there's only, you know, don't get me wrong, like, if I had a chance to go to school, like, a really good art school, I would still go, but it's just that right now I don't exactly have the opportunity, and I really don't feel like asking my parents, like, you know, help for, like, to go to art schools that I actually want to. I want to be able to, like, you know, afford that myself and eventually, like, you know, move to the States and attend schools there.
Mm-hmm. Which ones are you aiming to like attend? I'm basically, the reason I'm asking is I'm in a similar position right now. I feel like I'm working, but I don't even have a strong foundation. I mean, my work is enough to provide to the client, but I struggle a lot with like every commission, every job, because I have to learn at the same time as I work, and I want to go to States as well and just go there again and try to learn more. For example, at Concept Design Academy, that looks really cool. I don't know, are there any schools you're looking forward to attend in the States?
If I can sacrifice a kidney, if somebody wants to buy my kidney, okay, I will be willing to go to Art Center, just saying. Yeah. Any buyers? No? Yes?
I will tell you in a few minutes when we have the feedback from the people in the chat. I'm sure there's people in the chat who need kidneys. Would you be able to sacrifice a liver? Because I think me or Darek could use one.
Oh, yeah. Only one liver, though. You can have half of my liver.
Okay.
I don't drink, so, you know, it's pretty healthy, just saying.
Perfect.
Yeah, that will be useful for them. Oh, God.
By the way, guys, it's a joke. We are actually all not really big alcohol lovers. It just started as a joke, and then it just kind of got out of control, and everyone started associating Level Up with vodka. I don't know why. It's just...
You messaged me yesterday. You guys were drinking, so...
Well, no, man, I don't really...
Yeah, man.
Actually, I have some Bacardi, man.
What the fuck? did you come from?
You want some?
Yeah, all right.
I can prepare some glasses.
Hey guys, it's Darek.
Yeah.
Hey, it's guys. Darek Zabrocki.
Yeah, we have a Bacardi and.
Yay! Okay, man, let's have a drink.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. God, hey, guy, Darek, how can you. You were in Poland.
Oh, Jesus. Oh.
Darek.
Yeah. He's a bit strong. But, yeah.
Okay, he's gonna take over.
What the hell? I mean. What the hell
yeah,
just happened?
Right. I just you know jump in the plane and I'm here.
So okay.
That's why I'm late right now.
Oh my god. Okay.
This is Polish stuff that Jonas already told at the beginning.
Oh man. I need to have some more of that.
Yeah. Okay, guys. Okay, I will just pick some questions and you will take care of yourself. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, so Betty, how long have you been practicing before you started painting professionally?
2 years.
Okay, so it was 2 years, and it was like you were painting before, or it was just a fresh start for you with all the like digital stuff and.
Yeah, I used to be a traditional artist, but to be honest, I didn't really find like that much difference. It's like different media, but like it's the same concept. You just take a pen and you draw.
Yeah.
I guess like, you know, Photoshop there's more shortcuts. You can't exactly do an overlay on like, you know, a canvas. Well, actually you can. You can do a wash, but that's something else.
Yeah, that's true. I find it really cool to see, actually to go back to traditional media and find like glazing methods and oils that actually relate to some of the ways you can reapply it in Photoshop. So it's actually my way was a little bit different. I started as digital, then going back to traditional. With you, it was all traditional first and then digital, right?
Yeah, most people are like that, but
yeah. I think it's a much faster way to learn because you are not overwhelmed by the amount of tools and weird glowing stuff that you can do in Photoshop, right? Okay, guys, how are you feeling out there? Okay. I guess that's enough. Okay.
No, me and Derek are working on some overpaints.
Yep.
Together on one tablet.
Yeah.
You're holding a pen.
Like, I'm holding the pen and Derek's moving my arm because he's a better painter than me.
With some shortcuts.
That's okay. About okay. Do whatever you want.
Yeah.
Do whatever you want. Let me pick another question. Okay, so that's the hardest question we are really asking every guest, which is, would you rather be Godzilla or the billionaire, Betty?
Godzilla or what?
Or billionaire?
I guess a billionaire, because I can just use money to become Godzilla. right? Yes?
That's smart. Yeah, that's the question. That works. I mean, there was plenty of Godzillas recently, so I guess that's a good choice to be a billionaire right now. I mean, yeah, Godzilla has fun in San Francisco right now. Had fun. I mean, with that. Have you seen Godzilla, the newest one?
No, I haven't actually. Smell it.
There's a lot of hype around that.
Should I go see it? Cause like I was planning to go see X-Men, but
yeah, I think I'm looking forward to seeing X-Men a little bit more than Godzilla.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't have any friends who wants to actually go see Godzilla for some reason.
Yeah.
That's so sad because a lot of my friends worked on it. It really hurts my friends.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'll just go watch it by myself then.
That's even worse.
Is it? Well, excuse me then. Whatever.
I'm kidding. I haven't seen it myself, but I'm actually pretty keen to see it. From what I've heard, it actually sounds pretty cool.
Like. Also, guys, my computer's lagging a little bit, so I'm trying to paint as best as I can.
Okay, no worries. I mean, it's enough right now. we can easily see what you are doing. So do you use any reference? For example, right now you're painting a face, right? And you're just painting from memory, or?
No, I actually have a reference on my other screen.
Okay, so is it like the research you do before you start to paint, and then you compile it into one big file and try to paint from those, or is it just one photo?
Right now I have like 5 different photos for all the faces.
Okay.
But like, you know, I think each element has like something I need. So I don't know. I find that if you want to paint realistically, like let's, you need reference. Unless you have like a perfect photographic memory, you still need reference for it.
Yeah, reference is so crucial in terms of getting that realistic feel in your work, unless you're, I don't know, genius and you can memorize all that stuff, like you just said. Like, it's not common to have that skill, so it's not cheating using reference at all. There's no cheating in professional industry, right? Yeah, sometimes you have to do things that you wouldn't rather be doing with your private work. Yeah, I mean, in terms of production and such. Okay. So, you two guys are painting, right?
Yep.
Okay.
Very busy.
Okay, let me actually... There was a question to you, Betty. Okay. Can you show the reference photos? I don't know if you
remember. Oh, jeez. Okay.
Like, yeah, I think it would be cool for people to see how do you merge different...
I'm sorry. Oh my god, my screen just went white.
For no reason. Yeah, that's perfect.
Yeah, that's my reference right there. I'm so sorry. Oh, dear lord. Okay, this should be it. Reference. And it just froze.
Oh god. Why have I asked you for...
I am so sorry. My computer is a potato. It's utter shit.
Okay, so stop worrying about reference. I mean...
Okay.
Oh, there you go. It's there.
Well, okay, no, these are material references, actually.
Okay.
I don't have my face reference on this file. But would it be possible for me to just send the file to people who want to see it?
Yeah, no worries, we can skip that. Okay, so basically you gather all the photos into one file and try to, like, you have some material references in your, in the second file, and how do you use it? Do you just look at it, or do you copy-paste stuff from this file and try to paste it in Photobash? How do you use that kind of a reference folder?
I think I do a mixture of both, because, okay. I was actually planning to use this. Hang on. Time to do overlay. Yeah. Okay, this is an easy way to, like, you know, avoid painting metal too much. Oop. This is showing. Hang on. Whoa.
Hey, guys, who are watching, if you have any questions to Betty, please type them in with... the question before the question, so I can easily see the easily see it in the chat.
Bam, boobs.
There you go.
But yeah, you get my point. It's like, I don't know, for references, it's like a mixture of like, this material might look good on, like, you know, certain things, or like sometimes I just like, maybe I would take apart from this helmet and just, like, you know, play around, cut and paste, see how it looks on this. Unfortunately, this I don't really need this right now, but jeez, no, I don't need this. But I don't know. I look at pictures to see if I, like, I don't know, like, sometimes you just find, like, a part that you like, and you just incorporate it into your piece, or, like, I don't know, most of the time when I look at pictures, I just want to see how, like, the texture is, how to render that certain texture.
Okay. So there's a question, how do you achieve such smoothness on your character designs, faces, skin? I think the person is asking about that unified feel of your artwork. How do you achieve it? Is it the way you paint? Is it the way you, I don't know, how do you achieve that look?
How do I achieve
that, you know, that your look, your artwork kind feels kind of very unified. There's no trace or photos whatsoever. It looks unified. And how do you achieve that smooth look of the rendering and stuff? You just paint over it until it looks like you want it to look, or
basically, yeah, you just, like, you just have to, like, you incorporate the picture, but you gotta make sure you had to go over all your pictures. Or, like, you can leave some parts out, but you gotta make sure it doesn't stand out too much. So that's why, like, when I start off something rough, I usually paint it first and then incorporate the textures later.
Okay.
I'll just, like, you know, paint on top of the texture, because I usually find that kind of, that throws you off a little bit, because you're, like, working, you're kind of relying on the texture to, like, help you do something, when like, in reality, you have to, like, rely on yourself for your, your foundation for your work.
Yeah.
So, yeah, just hard work.
Yeah, hard work.
Just not exactly tricks to it.
Yeah, I guess it's just painting. Okay. Are you using, do you use Intuos or Cintiq? What exactly is your setup?
Oh, I have an Intuos tablet.
Okay, so just an Intuos. Yeah, no tricks in there as well.
No. Well, I don't know. I'm too cheap to buy anything else, so I would just stick to my tablet.
Yeah. I was thinking about getting a companion, Cintiq companion, but it's so damn expensive. Yeah. Looks kind of cool to have your tablet and laptop in the same device, so we can, I don't know, travel with it and such. So I was thinking about getting one to just do some planner or something like that. We'll see. Do you have any experience with Cintiq or painting on your screen?
Yeah, when I was at Sheridan, all we have were Cintiq. And I don't know, I have really, really bad experiences with it, because, like, all the computers we have, they were Mac. And, like, I don't know. I just find, like, painting on Mac, it's just, like, such a bad experience, because, like, the color is just so, like, poorly calibrated. So, like, sometimes when I paint on a Mac and then I go back home and, like, put it on my screen again, it just looks so different. And then I had to, like, rework everything again. So, I don't know.
You're talking about these big iMacs, right? 27 inches.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Okay.
I think mostly, usually, it's a gamma issue rather than a color issue, because Mac uses a different gamma than PC does. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of times things will tend to look too dark if you made them on a Mac and then bring them over to PC.
Yeah, that's true. That's what I noticed the MacBook Pro I have. It's very contrasty.
Yeah. The safest thing to do is to really check your values all the time. If your values are good, then usually your image will look okay on most monitors. And then the second thing to do is to keep, like, to control your saturation, to try not to go too saturated. Because then if you look at it on a more saturated screen, it's going to oversaturate. So if you keep that those two things in a safe range, then you can usually work on almost any monitor, in my personal experience.
Okay, there's tons of other questions coming. People are just raging at me that I ask people to ask questions, but then don't pick any. So yeah, let's start picking questions. I mean, I'm trying to do that, but I pick questions from the beginning of the chat, so I can actually go through all of them, so don't rage at me. Betty, do you do any kind of regular exercises to improve? I mean, you already said that you're not learning in the way you attend any school or whatsoever. But what do you think is the best way to, and the most effective way to get better for people that are starting out, or how did you do it?
Just draw every day.
Yeah, that's a simple answer, but...
Yeah, I'm sorry, I don't know, I can't really tell you anything else. You just have to put lots of time and effort into it. Honestly, that's all you need to do. But, I don't know, I went to art classes since I was in middle school, so I think that helped. Just learn your fundamentals. When you have your fundamentals down, it's pretty easy from there on.
Yeah, you have to force through this fundamental stage when you are setting up these core skills to go with later on. They are so important, so you don't want to skip them. So, is there anything you can tell us about the stuff you're doing right now? What are you thinking about? And is it just a rendering phase when you're just on an autopilot, or you're thinking about something in particular?
What am I thinking about? I think I'm just, I don't know, I'm already always really careful about the way I render skin, because I find that sometimes, I don't know, right now I'm trying out a new skin tone. Usually I just use too much orange, but they look really tanned. So I'm trying to go for a more soft pinkish approach to this one. I don't know, I'm not sure if that's working, but I'm trying my best.
If you want, guys, I can talk about overpaint, because I'm not going to do too much work on this one.
Okay, go ahead, man.
Yep.
Yeah, Betty, we are switching from your screen to Jonas. And
okay.
Just for a minute.
Woo!
Pressure off.
Okay, so since we were talking about Godzilla, I picked this... Godzilla piece from, let me just flip it. I guess this is the artist, Pablo de la Parra Ebrard. Okay. Pablo's piece. And it's kind of done in a more cartoony or manga or, anime style or something, which I quite liked, so I didn't want to destroy that too much. But there's just a couple of things that I just noticed right away that just didn't sit well with me, and that's the lighting and the values. So if I check him, first of all, the nails and the teeth and the eyes just pop out so hard, just bam in your face, which is kind of weird because the person is going for back illumination, so the fire behind him is less bright than the nails. That's really strange to me. Look at this value. This is almost pure white. Wow, that's way, way too strong. So the first thing I did was basically just darken that stuff down a little bit. And I made the eye smaller because I think his eyes sort of dwarfed him. What I mean is that the bigger a creature gets, the smaller eyes tends to get, or at least that's a way that you can sort of show that the creature is bigger by making the eyes smaller in terms of scale. So I made the eyes smaller and I darkened that a little bit. And then after that, I started looking at the lighting of this piece. And what I found strange is that there's all these highlights here, but there's no real light source backing them up. So there's all we see is fire in a dark background. So why is there a gray lighting everywhere? And why is there all these weird rim lights on top and stuff? It just doesn't really make sense. So first of all, I tried to remove that and then just paint in some spill light from the fire that you would catch and try to follow the surface here. And after that, I just sort of glowed everything out a bit more, trying to get those values better. And at the end, I added a bounce light on the top so that we can read the form a little bit better again. So you will see the difference that, you know, it just, the read is completely different. Obviously, yeah. I've gone for a more realistic read, but I think splitting your light sources and then being consistent about them, because here there's really no interaction with the fire. It's just the person was just going like, okay, I just need to add highlights to make this interesting, but he did not think about what to do. So here you feel like there's something coming from above. There's something sort of, you know, lighting it up slightly more. It could be moonlight or whatever, or some bounce light. And then underneath you feel the light of the fire. Same with the hand. It just didn't really sit well. And then I added some saliva because he's hungry. So. Yeah, that's pretty much it for this one, I think.
Awesome, man.
So, really back cool. to Betty.
Jonas can take care of questions. I'm doing my okay. own right now. I find it rather okay. difficult to talk.
Is our guest still there? Oh no, she got kicked.
Oops. Oh, that's rude.
She's gone. She's just gone, man.
Oh, God.
Okay. I will put the screen on you for a minute, and I will contact her.
Perfect. Hey, guys. Oh, there you go.
Sorry, I got cut off.
Yeah.
My bad. I'm back.
Okay, cool. So, Betty, here's a question for you. If you are in a room with me, Wojtek, and Darek, and you have to shoot two of them to get out, who are you going to shoot?
Oh, why do you have to ask me such a question?
Because it's funny. No pressure.
I don't know.
I would shoot all of them.
Yeah, I think I'll just shoot all of them just to be fair. Like, you know what? Less competition. Bye.
Okay.
Hey, man. It's a fair game.
Last time I'm inviting you to level up shooting.
Yeah. Sorry. I was too fair. Like, I wouldn't shoot any of you. I would take a bullet for you guys.
Oh, okay. Thank you. That's really nice of you.
No. I kid.
Oh, the worst question ever.
I don't know.
I would shoot all of them.
Yeah, I think I'll just shoot all of them just to be fair.
What happens?
You know what? Let's competition.
Sorry about the
second audio.
Ew, I sound so gross online.
Actually, that's everyone's perception about themselves, really, trust me. It's just something weird that humans have with hearing yourself. You just think like, oh, man, I must be so annoying to listen to. That's how I feel, at least. When I hear myself, I'm just like, oh, dude, shut up. Dude, shut up.
What the fuck are you talking about? You don't even...
But, yeah, I don't know.
Betty, can you share your screen so we can see the stuff you are doing, and maybe talk a little bit about the progress.
Clicking screen share. It's not letting me for some reason. Hang on. Oh, there it is. Boop.
There you go. Yeah, it's fine.
Progress. I'm just trying to tighten the face more, because, like, I don't know, it seems a little bit flat right now, so I just want to bring more dimension to it. Mm-hmm. Like, this is what I started off with at first, and now I have this. It's more shiny.
Yeah.
So you're basically layering really slowly at a time, like layering all the skin levels and the speculars and stuff, too.
Yeah.
To bring it
warm. Just wait until I get to the pores. You'll love that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, sorry guys if this is like kind of boring for you, but it just It's just the way I work. It's just like layering and like a lot of rendering. It's a painful process.
I mean, it's not boring at all.
Don't worry about it. Most people are asking if they can marry you, so it's no worry.
I don't even know what to say.
Yeah, I agree.
Just blush and say nothing.
Okay.
Yeah, what's really funny is that, I mean, I don't find your approach boring. I mean, we had like over 20 guests, and we didn't have a situation where the approach was the same from like two particular artists. It's all different. Everyone's approach is different, and that's so cool to explore and to see really how everybody is approaching even, I don't know, the same kind of style. And I don't know, it's just super exciting for me to see. And, you know, I get a lot of stuff from watching other artists' work. It gives me a lot of ideas about...
Yeah. This is actually the real reason why we do Level Up, is we want to steal all of you guys' techniques.
Yeah, and then vanish.
And then steal your jobs after that.
Yeah, and then vanish like Craig Mullins. Hawaii. Yeah, so just unsubscribe and leave the channel. Okay.
Okay, I'll look at the questions. They're just a lot of silly questions, so
yeah,
I'll try to pick
it's
out
really hard to
serious ones.
Anything.
It's okay, I like silly questions.
Okay, well, I'll try to switch it up because, you know, I still want people to learn something so it doesn't get too goofy. Someone's asking if you ever use airbrush mode, and if yes, how it impacts your work.
I don't think I ever use airbrush.
Does anyone?
Yeah.
It's an airbrush.
Okay, here's a good one. How about colors? Do you think of color palettes beforehand, or do you sort of go with the flow? How do you approach color palettes in your designs?
I don't know. How do I go with my colors? sometimes I have it planned out. I don't know. A lot of work you see on my website, they're actually for work.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of times they choose the palettes for me.
Okay.
But like when I don't, you know, when I don't have someone telling me what colors to use, I usually like, you know, choose where we. I don't know. I'm not like a really big fan of vibrant colors. I like, you know, softer, more subtle colors. It's like that's just the way I don't know. Well, basically, I used to like paint mostly grayscales. So I don't know. Like the color is still a tricky thing for me, and I'm still trying to learn how to utilize it properly, but. I don't know. I don't exactly plan out my colors from the beginning. I usually, you know, play around, see what works or not, and I go from there.
Okay. I think vibrant colors are just tricky to get right. I mean, it's easy to get too much. So I think it's nice to start in sort of a subdued color palette and then work your way up kind of from there.
I think there's a lot of approaches, and I heard an exact opposite opinion about working with color. So I wouldn't go with any of those. I would just go and see what works for you or anybody. It's just that there's tons of different opinion about that.
Or
should I go with like vibrant underpainting first and paint my way with like a little bit less saturated colors, or should I go with like totally desaturated colors and build it up with saturated ones? I mean, whatever. Study people you want to get the look of and see how they work. Discover what you like. If you like that look, you have to discover how it's achieved and then implement it into your work. I don't know, you can ask artists, you can look for tutorials, you can deconstruct it. There's tons of ways to learn, and you just have to know what you like. You have to have an opinion. And sometimes that's the hardest thing to have. Yeah, Wojtek on the rant again.
Okay, so Diego is asking you, Betty, how did you learn your fundamentals?
I went to a Chinese art class, and they made me draw fruits a lot. That's basically where I learned my fundamentals. I don't know. Well, I went to this art class. It was like run by these like sketchy Asian people in their basement. That's basically where I first started. Like, you know, they were good teachers, but like at the same time, it was like really sketch. It was like in this person's basement, and like it always smelled like food. Like, there would always be like tons of shoes in the door. Like one time, like somebody stole my shoe, and I was just like, "What the hell?" Because like we all had to leave our shoe at the front door, and like someone just took mine. I'm like, "Okay, well, great."
So I had to, like, it's kind of a compliment.
Yeah, I have good taste in shoes, but
Good taste.
I don't know. I started when I was in middle school, I think, because like my parents were just like, "Oh my God, Betty, you're like." You don't like to do anything, so, you know, we're just going to make you go into art, because, like, at least you do that pretty well. So I was like, oh my God, Mom, why? I don't want to do anything, because, like, you know, at that age, you don't exactly want to do anything that your parents tell you to do. So, you know, the fact that I got into art, I had to, like, you know, give credit to my parents, because, like, I think they were the ones who pushed me to really go and try my best at, like, what I do.
Yeah, that's interesting. And did you grow up in Canada or did you grow up in China most of the time?
No, I grew up in China.
Okay, whereabouts?
Beijing, mainland.
All right. So yeah, that's quite interesting because, you know, I would assume that definitely in most Asian cultures, it's even less likely that parents are going to support an art career because they're completely, you know, ignorant to the, you know, being able to make a living off of it, as far as I know. So it's... Yeah, it's pretty amazing that your parents were actually pushing you in that direction rather than you were yourself.
Well, the thing is, like, I came from like a family with like art background. Like, my uncle was a ballet dancer. He actually got his he actually went to Russia for training, and then he opened his own ballet studio. And my other uncle, he's an architecture who sponsored for like the Chinese Olympic. And my other uncle just, like, he paints traditional Chinese paintings. So I think that's partially the reason why my parents were so supportive.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome.
Yeah. And so was he making a living off of just of selling his paintings then? Or?
Yeah, he's a freelancer.
Okay. One of the questions I have... is if you can make any suggestions for a person who's trying to get into game concept art or into the game concept art industry.
Like how to get jobs?
Yeah, I guess so.
I would say find a studio that you actually want to work for and basically make your portfolio towards that, like, you know, what they look for and like what they ask for. Like, you know, when I first started, I went to all the studio sites and I like looked up all the requirements and like what they're looking for, and like I just took down notes, and basically I just make all the things that they ask for in their what do they call them? The recruitment sheets. I don't know. Like, just do your research. Like, if you want to work for certain like game studios, you just have to like. Work in their style, and like if they're looking for something, just make sure you make your portfolio piece based on that, and make sure to market yourself. You know, don't be afraid to spam them. They don't reply, it's okay. No shame in that. Just keep on trying. Don't give up. Sometimes it takes, like, you know, companies forever just to reply to you. Like, you know, when I was looking for a job, like I would get like. Replies like a month later, even though I had a job already, so I had to, you know, turn them down. But I don't know,
The thing is, they will get back to you at their convenience, not at yours. If they don't need you at the time, then they probably just ignore you. And then if they suddenly need you, they'll, you know, they'll email you or call you and expect you to sort of be ready. That's kind of how the industry works.
And I guess, like, you know, it really helps to have friends in the industry because they're the ones who, you know, who can give you a heads up if someone, like, company is looking for someone, or they can give you the recommendation, which is, like, basically how I got my job because, like, a friend from my school recommended me, and then I basically just got the job on spot. They offer me an art test. They're just like, oh, just do this. We'll pay you for it. And then, like, you know, yeah, just connections is everything sometimes.
Okay.
Yeah, so exactly. That's why it's so important to really do some networking and talk to people, like make friends, like meet another artist. Sometimes it's as easy like your artist friend getting rid of the jobs that he cannot handle by himself. So yeah, so it's really important to go to conventions if you are able to attend the workshop if you have any in your area and meet people. Actually, I found that type of networking 10 times more effective than networking through internet. So it's really easy to.
Well, I would say yes and no. I mean, you have to be able to prove a certain skill level before networking through people is going to do you any good. If your work isn't strong enough yet, there's no point really. But I think once you reach a professional level, you can live off word to mouth almost entirely. Okay, you don't agree.
I don't know, like.
This is my experience. It might be different for someone else, but that's how I see it.
I mean, I got discovered, even though my work wasn't professional, and it did good for me. So I wouldn't be here if I wouldn't be spreading my shitty work over the internet without, you know, having. I didn't have that much experience or skill, or, you know, I just was showing devotion and passion, and I know it's maybe not usually, it's not happening very, it's not common. So, I don't know. This is just the thing that worked for me.
There's also a thing, people see potential as well, you know. Even if you're not that experienced, but you show potential, that can be enough for someone to hire you and believe in you, you know. Like, you don't have to have a lot of work experience. But there has to be something there that people see that convinces them, like, okay, yeah, this person is someone.
Yeah, so how exactly can they tell that you have potential if they don't see your work?
No, they have to see your work, obviously.
Yeah.
They have to see your work. But I'm just saying that you don't need a lot of work experience or even that much work in your portfolio. I mean, just a few pieces can be enough to show someone, like, okay, this person.
Sometimes even one piece is a reason for some art director to hire you. Just because
it's your skill. It happens, yeah. Better be your piece then. Otherwise you're screwed.
Yeah.
I don't know. Well, I'm not speaking just from experience, but like from what I heard from like a lot of my friends, some people they aren't suited for the job, but like they're hired anyways because they have connections to the industry. And I don't know, I guess, like, I don't want to badmouth people, but, like, some people just, like, they're not ready for it yet. But at the same time, you know, with the connection and everything, like, sometimes you just you have people who just get the job, but they're not suited for it. Mm-hmm. So, like, things like that happen.
Yeah, I mean, it does happen, but on the other hand, what I also see a lot is that people are being brought into companies and then just trained internally, and I actually don't think there's anything wrong with that. I see it a lot at MPC where there's people who are brought into the company, and you think, like, oh, they're not really ready for it, but they show, like, you know, a passion, or they show that they're driven to learn and get better, and then they sort of, you know, they learn stuff as they do it, and then within a year or a year and a half, they're they're really good. And then if you offer that to a person as a company, it's also easier for you to keep them there, you know, because you know, basically, yeah, it's part of the contract, the fact that they're training you in-house. So I see this happen quite a lot, actually. I don't think you have to be full-on professional to step into a job, and you know it'd be most awesome. If you can, that's better because you'll be in a power position, kind of. You'll sort of get to call the shots. And if it happens the other way around, you're more like, how should I say? You're part of the company because you sort of owe them the training, so they sort of expect a loyalty as a result of that. I don't know, maybe in games it's different. This is a typical film thing, I think.
Oh, maybe. Because I don't think I ever worked for film, so I'm just speaking from experience from like game industries and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Cricket.
Silence. Jonas, have you felt asleep?
No, I'm looking at the questions.
Yeah, it's hard to filter those today, right?
Yes, it is. Kristen asks, is it unrealistic, because it's kind of what we were talking about, is it unrealistic to get work with AAA studios such as Blizzard when you're entering the industry? No, that's actually just what we said. It just depends on how good your work is. And
you can enter the industry at a certain level of skill. Like, I know people that weren't doing any work at all, but they were sitting at home and working their asses off just to get a certain skill level, and then they just jumped in and worked on Halo or something.
Yeah.
And it happened. Yeah. Happened with one Polish artist that I know. So.
It's possible.
Yeah. It's possible, but like, well, if you're gonna work, like, you know, if you're gonna travel overseas to go to the studio, you have to be really careful because like, there's issue with work visa. Because like, I think most work visas they like, you need a degree or like 3 years of experience to actually get it. Like, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, but like, I just heard that from like a friend. So.
Not that I've heard of. I mean, it depends where you're going. But for example, if you're European and you're going to the States and you want to get a work visa there, it's basically up to the studio or the company that's hiring you to convince the American government that you're worth bringing in instead of getting them to hire someone locally. But it's not really based on your degree. I mean, it helps, obviously. All the information helps, degrees, work experience, etc. But I'm not sure that it's an actual requirement.
Yeah, the paper will not work for you. No? Even if you have a master degree or something, it's still the most important how in the practice you are. So.
Yeah, I have a master degree and no one's ever looked at it. It's probably in a dungeon somewhere, rotting away.
Oh yeah, master's degrees.
Right? Yeah.
I don't know, maybe it's like a little bit different in Canada, so I don't know. I will look into it, but
well, it's interesting to hear that it's not the same everywhere, so I guess there's no real sort of one rule to follow. I guess it sort of depends on the companies or the type of industry that you're working in. Just try to get good guys, just kick ass and everything will be fine. Like Darek is doing right now.
Yeah, just finished the overpaint, so...
Yeah?
Yeah, just okay. In a minute.
Okay, let me check the questions again.
We can also have some resources books that we found in London with Jonas last time.
Oh yeah.
And maybe we can start with if Betty has any resources books that can recommend for our viewers right now.
Okay, so
like like the resources that you could recommend to learn the basics, or you know, or you were introduced to when you were learning, Betty?
Resources?
Yeah, there are some books to for people to with fundamentals or stuff like this.
To be honest, like the way I learn, the way I got myself into concept art is like I just looked at a lot of concept artists' work and like try to copy them. Well, like not copy, like, you know, design stuff, but just like, you know, I look at their art and I try to like do it in their style. Like, I don't exactly know how to direct you to any sources, but a lot of it just like, you know, you gotta do what works for you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think so what works best is like you discover what you like and what you want to pursue, and then you just go for it. Like, you know, there's nothing really stopping you but yourself. So at the end of the day, you know, you're your own teacher.
Okay, so maybe you must share the screen in mind, so I can show the people the book that we found in the museum.
Oh yeah, okay, all right. Okay, it's on you.
Yeah, lately we were so inspired by the armors of the knights from the Middle Ages, and we found a very cool book. It's called Masterpieces of European Arms and Armor in the Wallace Collection. It can be found on the Amazon for 34 pounds. And what I can tell is,
can you share your screen? Sure.
Oh shit.
Yeah, I was about to say that. Well, it's pretty. That's dark. I mean, it's still beautiful, but
gorgeous.
Okay. It's working now.
Yeah.
So what can I say? It's like a high quality book with a lot of pictures and story behind the armors, how they are built, and you know the clear work to be comfortable for the knights and different divisions. So we can definitely put the link into our resources on the page. I also got some pretty nice link from my friend Bastien Lefkos, the Harmer, and he just gave me a link to the site where our a lot of books in the links, so we can also give the link to it because there's a lot of you know the names of the books that you can use for your reference and for the if you are starting to the business. Yeah. So another one, I found some pretty nice fantasy illustration connected with Tolkien works, and these are all traditional paintings. My friend Michal sent me. So it is also very worth checking how it was all built on the, you know, canvas with all the paintings. It's amazing. A lot of quality pictures in it. So we will definitely share the links right now, and maybe I can also discuss the other thing now.
Yeah, sure.
So first, painting today, it's made by Ricardo Laiesa, the original painting. And it's cool with all the values and stuff. But I wanted to make the composition a bit more interesting, because if you see that all the background is very nice, outlining the gradient of the sky, but the but the clouds are a bit rough and sketchy alike. So the same with mountains. All the parts with the snow covering the mountain rocks. It's like one, you know, size brush. It's not that diversified. And I wanted to fix it somehow.
Yeah, it kills the scale, right?
Yeah, I also extended the canvas and put some textures at the beginning to just you know suggest the better detail on the mountain, add some atmospheric effects, but still had you know the sunny day and the sunny only paintings, lightings. So add some more orangey colors to enrich the palette in the lower parts of the picture. Just make the bigger clouds with just bigger strokes of the brush. So as far as it was pretty cool with the values, but the brush strokes and brush work didn't fit the overall solids. So yeah, I think it's more about the variation with the brush size. So then,
and I got cut off.
The bigger brush you have to use, so it's like this. And, yeah, I think that's it.
Awesome, man.
So now we're trying to put the links in the group and event page. So
okay.
If you really find it, if you really want to be inspired with some armors and the stuff that was done traditionally, just go into event page in 2 minutes and we will post the link. But that's it.
Yeah, sorry that Darek sounds a bit far, but he is speaking through my microphone.
Yeah.
But if we put both our microphones on, we get this crazy feedback.
Yeah.
So, sorry about that.
Was I even clear?
I think so. Wojtek, did you understand Darek's explanation? Or?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Yeah, it looks really nice. It's, some epic mist and mountains in there.
Yeah, the castle that was inspired by your yesterday showcase. Yeah. Okay, go back to Betty.
So Betty, now you've gone into poor rendering, I see.
Yep.
Do you use any photo textures for that, or you just use like scatter brushes and stuff too?
You can use a mixture of both, but right now I just want to use my called magic dot brush. It's just like a little simple speckled, I don't know. It just like to give like, I don't know. Without it, I feel like the face is just like really flat and just like plastic looking. So I want to give him some texture.
Yeah, you're basically introducing imperfections in the skin, right?
Yeah, I think like having some imperfections like what makes it look more real.
Yeah. It's really nice how you use this more saturated colors in the shadows of skin to suggest that subsurface in there. That always works really well with skin. You can even exaggerate it a little bit, I think, usually. And it looks nice.
Thank you.
Do you ever check your pieces in black and white while you're working? Because I haven't seen you do that. Or do you just eyeball it?
I usually just eyeball it.
Okay.
Well, I don't know. At the end of the day, I do check once in a while. But usually, like, I don't know. Usually you can see what's wrong with, like, certain areas.
Yeah, I guess it's something that you learn over time to not rely on black and white to see it, right? It's an experience thing.
Yeah, to be honest, I don't exactly use the black and white thing at all. Like,
okay.
If it looks wrong, it's usually just wrong. You can tell.
Yeah, the thing that it helps me with is that I think I've said this before, is that the color saturation tricks you into believing that you're looking at a different value. That's, I think, the most dangerous part. When you use a really saturated color, you tend to think that it's a brighter value than it actually is. Then you look in black and white and you realize it's just a gray or whatever. Because yeah, it's an element. Definitely, saturation is an element of color that pops, that is actually outside of your value control. So you can play with that.
Yeah, I should start doing that.
But your color palettes are really nice. They're very subtle, and very
realistic. Right?
Yeah, and yeah, unified. Like Wojtek was saying, like there's always a unification. And I think it works with just simple tricks. How you can unify. Like I can see now that you're, you know, like if I just look at your thumbnail, how I can see the unification is, for example, there's some gold on her hood. There's some gold on her arm. And then there's some gold spill on her breastplate. So these colors are returning, and then the white from the breastplate, the highlights, is returning in her hair, and then the blue from her cloth is returning in her eyes, in her iris of her eyes. So like basically making colors return in that way is going to give you a sense of unification.
It's all subdued and very natural, mm-hmm. without any exaggeration. Light is very natural, like it was in some photo studio, within just normal, you know, white room. And it's a bit hard to get that kind of, you know, subdued colors, because they are, you know, they have a lot of variations, and below the skin. It depends on the part, when the bones are, and the muscles, on the face. So that is, it's crazy cool coloring the parts.
I also feel like the smoothness comes from, because I see that you do like really soft. You have a soft opacity, so you're doing really soft layering of brushes, and. Yeah, it gives a really nice, smooth result, sort of.
Well, that's basically, I think, an edge control, like an amazing edge control. Something that is soft, something that needs hard edge is super hard, and yeah, it's like perfect edge control that gives you that the whole spectrum of edges, from soft to firm to loss to, you know, to, yeah, something like that. I think it works because of that. If you pay enough attention to your edges, things tend to look, if you use the whole spectrum of the edges, for example, if you look at her cheek, the edge, I would say, is very soft, almost totally lost between certain values. There's no transition, but then there's a pretty firm edge between her cheek and the line of hair, and then there's super sharp edge between her cheek and her nose. So there's a really firm edge between these two values. It comes from practice. I mean, I think it's sometimes a matter of personal taste. Where do you want to put a certain edges? I mean, you have to put them in a certain. You cannot put. I mean, there's no like rules to it. But to achieve a somewhat realistic effect, you have to speak this language of edges. But then there is some leeway in a certain like Betty is getting pretty up close to that face, so she can do basically with edges whatever she wants and. She chooses the way to get, I think, to get into that really smooth and to use the whole spectrum of edges to get that effect.
Yeah, and once in a while, I just got to remind myself to zoom out, because sometimes I work so long on one area, and then I zoom out later, then I'm like, oh my god, this totally doesn't work with the rest of the face. And next thing you know, I just lost 2 hours of work, and I had to restart again. So that's something I got to keep on reminding myself. Just I always need to zoom out or have like the navigator on.
Yeah, it's funny because it really depends the zoom level that you look at something, how it reads. And a lot of stuff that looks really good up close just doesn't work from far. Yeah. It's really frustrating. So it's very important to keep.
It's really easy to over, you
know, to overlook
over
the, it.
Yeah, over the tail end.
Yeah.
One part, and when you zoom out, it's like from different picture.
Yeah, like I always save older versions, and a lot of times I'm detailing, and then I look back at an older and I older version, and I just feel like a certain part has just lost its freshness, and even like the added detail is not really adding anything to it. So I just delete that area and just mask it back to a much older version to get some of the roughness back into it.
Yeah, especially with the sketches where the movement is much, you know, easier to just outline.
Yeah. Yeah, it's nice.
Jonas, I think you can switch to my screen. I think I don't. Let me actually share my screen.
Cool.
Oh, ooh la la.
Don?
Yeah, we're looking at you.
Okay. So this is a work by Kristen Lonsdale, and I kind of like the overall idea. I mean, I like the colors, kind of the Bokuro kind of feel to the overall color palette and stuff. And I was like, okay, that a lot of things work, but then there's just small areas that I think just need some attention, and I just kept doing my thing. So I have added some context to it. So basically, it looks like that right now. I have changed it quite a lot, and I will just go through the stuff to show you what I did. Actually, I like that much more. I think that's just enough. So first off, I felt like the face isn't quite. That's not the expression I would shoot for. It's not clear. So I would shoot for something more subtle. And then I introduced some warmer light. As you can see, this kind of a light. What the hell?
yeah, man. Bringing the background.
This light in here is getting more desaturated as it goes up. So I tried to get that green kind of a feel and introduce maybe some kind of a forest context. So basically that she's laying in a forest and there's some, I don't know, spirit forest kind of thing floating. I don't know, that I just felt like I will add some background to add depth. And I just kept refining it. Yeah, I toned down the highlights because I specified the light source. So basically, I told myself, okay, maybe there is a light source from the top that is lighting there with like a little bit overcast light. So I cheated a lot. So with that green light, it's not certainly true, but it kind of get the job done. It's kind of a warm backdrop for this cold ascent, and then I kept being consequent to these light sources, so I toned down the bright highlights in these areas so it would sit in that value range. As you can see right now, I'm just trying to get rid of all these bright spots and stuff. Yeah, so basically I think that's it. There's one trick that I want to show you. As you can see, I switched to black and white with just one click, and I can still sample real colors and paint with them, but there's no layer to do that in here. And what I do, I use the proof setup thing. So basically if you will hit Control Y, it will go to your CMYK mode, right? So I changed it to go to black and white mode, which is
cool.
More correct to I mean, if you will go to in here and go and do hue saturation, lower the saturation, it will be different than this. It's just that it's more correct. As you can see, as I'm switching it on and off, this layer, it gets the saturated colors a little bit wrongly. As you can see, it's...
Yeah, the highlights are gone.
Yeah, the highlights are gone and stuff. So to do that, you just want to go to... So basically, I'm just hitting Control Y to go to Proof Setup, hit Custom, and the window will pop up, and just change this. There will be a lot of options in here. Dot gain 20%, and hit OK. And then it's working just like that. You can just go and go to your black and white mode and paint with color at the same time. So I can sample, and you can see I'm sampling the real color and actually painting with it. Let me create a layer. I'm actually painting not with white, but with that core that I sampled. Yes, that's a cool trick that I'm using a lot recently to get really to get a value check really quick. So yeah, signing up.
Cool.
Cool.
Back to you, Betty. Screen's on you.
Oh, hello.
Hello.
Hello there.
So how much time do you usually spend rendering a face? Is this because it's you tend to look at the face first? Is this the part that you spend most of the time rendering and you leave the rest a little bit rougher? Or?
Yeah, I have to admit, I usually work a lot more on the faces than like any other parts.
Mm-hmm.
Like right now, I say this is 40% done with the face. Like
the face is 40% done.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Good joke. Yeah, that's a good joke. Yeah.
No, I'm serious. Like,
how is that 40%?
I will be zoomed in. I will be zoomed in with a run brush, rendering like a pore. That's what I do sometimes.
Yeah, but please don't.
Like, luckily for girls, it's a lot faster because like I don't need to worry about wrinkles and stuff, and I can just like it's usually a lot faster. But either way, it's hard work.
Yeah, so we can assume that always the face is like your most main focal point of the on the picture of your design, right? The character.
Yeah, that's correct.
So, how much time do you need to finish all the picture? Approximately.
Probably like a week.
Wow, okay.
Yeah. But like, if I was to use more pictures, probably like, 2 days.
Mm-hmm.
With no sleep.
With no sleep. What are you doing to yourself? That's not healthy.
You just tortured yourself.
Yeah.
Hey, man, I don't know. Right now, my sleeping schedule is so messed up. Like, I will sleep at maybe 9 in the morning and then wake up at 2 and just work again and repeat.
Because the thing is, sleep is important because your brain is just going to function at a much slower rate if you don't get enough sleep. I mean, if I'm really, really tired, I can't paint. I can paint good at night, but if you're just like dozing off, then your productivity just goes down. It just plummets. So get some more sleep, Betty. Take care of yourself. Your health is very important.
Nope.
Okay.
Nope.
All right. So do you make some breaks while working all the day?
No breaks.
Okay.
Just hard
painting, sleeping, just painting.
Work hard.
Yep.
Okay.
What spirit do you need to break into the industry at the age of 21?
Don't sleep.
Paint.
Don't take breaks.
Yeah.
Just paint.
Just full on.
It's okay. You don't need to bathe. Just paint.
You don't need to bathe.
No, it's okay. I was joking. I bathe, but I don't know. Like, okay, I render a lot, and you don't exactly need. I hate to say this, but you don't exactly need too much thinking to render. It's like, for me, it's like, has gotten to a point where it's like, it's kind of mechanical for me.
Yeah, it's autopilot, right?
Yeah, just like, oh my god, I'm dead inside, but like, I'm still rendering.
Do you enjoy rendering that long? Like, does it give you pleasure, or is it just something that you feel you have to do?
Yeah, I think it's something I feel like I need to do.
But you need to.
It doesn't exactly give me pleasure when I'm like rendering dead at night by myself and like I haven't slept for 2 days. That doesn't exactly give me pleasure. But like, I don't know. Like, I think when I have my finished project, like when I have like finished all my stuff and I take it back and I step back and look, I feel like it's worth it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
The effort.
So you do it for yourself, right?
I do it mostly for myself.
Yeah. So, I mean,
if you are on the beginning, is on the first stage of your client work, you have to be assured that everything on the sketch fit well, and you can go farther with your rendering, right? Because some hardcore job, and then you have some revisions. It's like,
yeah,
it's I cannot imagine how it can look.
Well, the thing was like work. Sometimes you have to like kind of detach from it, because like if you get too attached to work, like sometimes can hurt you, because like the directors might not always make decisions that like that you're proud of.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they might just say like, "Oh, do this and that," and you're just like, "Oh my god, why would you do that? That is so tacky." But at the same time, you know, they're the one who's paying you, so they do it their way. So like, you know, I kind of learned to like, if it's something that isn't like I'm giving a task I don't like, I just do it. I don't think.
Mm-hmm. What happens if like let's say that your client is putting a really tight deadline on you? What kind of compromises would you make to make sure that you get it done in time?
Yeah,
that you can know you can meet that deadline and deliver in time. If say you don't have the time to like render an image for a week.
I don't know. I don't think I ever had that happen to me before. But well, I guess like depends on what the work is. Like if the person was to say like you know. Render this in a day in your style, I would just be like, no. I'd probably turn them down. Because that's kind of like asking me the impossible.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know. I don't know. I always feel really bad when I hand in something and I don't really like it. I feel like it's not 100% complete.
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
But like personally, I feel that it's important to distinguish the art side and the design side, because a lot of stuff that's made doesn't really look nice in terms of polishing or in terms of, you know, our love for a beautiful painting, but does do exactly its job in terms of, you know, being concept art, because concept art is most of the time just that, it's a concept, it's not,
it's more about idea.
It's about the idea rather than having something that's beautifully painted, you know. If you look at certain digital artists like Craig Mullins or Jamie Jones or something, I think a lot of people really enjoy them because from a passion for beautiful paintings point of view, they're really well executed. But from a concept art point of view, they're not necessarily, you know, more special than many other concept art from other people. So, yeah, like I always try to distinguish there because I know how you feel. I know it sucks to give something that you're not 100% about. But I also feel like sometimes you have to let that go because it's really something that's just in your mind and the production doesn't really care about the things that maybe you care about. And what you can always do, or what I sometimes do, if I'm not really happy with it but I've had to deliver it, then before I put it in my portfolio, I just work on it until I'm actually perfectly happy with it. And then you have your own version in your portfolio that, you're, you know, that you're content with.
I think I just never got to experience it, because like right now I work both as like a concept artist and an illustrator. So I don't know, most of the stuff I get right now is illustrations, and
that's different, I guess. Yeah, so that's like, because they give you the time to polish
it's
everything.
It's more about the final result.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Games, you really don't need that much concepts.
Sorry?
For Facebook games, you don't exactly need too many concepts for Facebook games, because like,
yeah,
it's so simple.
Mm-hmm.
Stop laughing at me, it's true.
People are already quoting you, and your quote of the day is, don't sleep. I always say you can sleep when you're dead.
Yeah. Exactly.
Time to sleep.
Sleep is for losers.
Don't waste your time on sleeping.
Oh, you're training a bunch of zombies right now.
Yeah. I actually can do it. I sleep between 6.5 to 7.5, 8 hours a night. And if I get any less, I just... I look like crap, I feel like crap, and I perform like crap. Darek is like, how much do you sleep?
Yeah, 5-6 hours.
Less, right?
Yeah.
But you can function on 5 hours. That's...
Yeah, but sometimes I need to, you know, get a nap at wide a day because it's...
Yeah.
Yeah, it just... You know, it just back to you next day or two next days. You're not a machine, so...
Yeah, exactly.
You know what? Actually, I find a regular schedule more effective for me. Like, waking up at, I don't know, 7 a.m.,
mm-hmm.
And I find these first couple of hours the most productive ones for me. And for example, just going to sleep at, I don't know, 11 p.m. up to midnight, and then you get like 7 hours of sleep, which is kind of a lot,
mm-hmm.
kind of enough, more than enough, I think. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, I just feel balanced when I do that, and it's when I go to like 4 a.m. Marathon or 5 a.m., which isn't really happening for me that often. I just feel so sorted for 2 or 3 days later on that I just cannot afford that, because I lose all my productivity. I lose my even my enthusiasm toward work, because I feel missed. I have to feel, I don't know, fresh. I have just a couple of like 3-4 hours when I can came up with ideas and do like heavy intellectual kind of designing and shit, and later on I can do only like rendering and mindless stuff. So it's just something that works for me. So just for you to know that there's tons of variety in terms of setting up your own schedule. You can go with can go with all-nighters, that's cool. I mean, some people are cool with that, and I understand. But for me, it's totally opposite. I have to do more.
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of a mix between things that are very personal, things that are just, you know, biologically inherent, being human. For example, I'm kind of a night person, and my brain goes on overdrive after 12 o'clock, and then I actually come up with a lot more ideas. But on the other hand, I think that going to sleep really late and getting up in the morning just sort of screws your head, just as a human, because you're sleeping during daylight hours, and it's just confusing for you. Like they say that every hour you get before midnight is worth 2. Mm-hmm. And in my personal experience, it really does feel like that way. If you actually go to bed at a proper hour, you get much more out of your sleep than if you stay up until the birds start whistling and you sleep halfway
having
through the day.
Schedule for day. It's also, it's also very cool. But the worst is when you finish all your job for all the day and you want to go bed, and you start feeling that I need to do something for myself, and you have mm-hmm. you know the choice whether it's to be in the bed right now
or paint.
And not doing, or just you know use that feeling that you have to you know pushing your imagination and yourself into doing something.
But that's really good when you have that, because not everyone has that. A lot of people get really tired from working, and then after that they just don't have the energy or the courage to do anything personal anymore.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if you can do that afterwards, if you're like, wow, I've been painting all day, and I still want to paint, but for myself this time.
Yeah, yeah. It really depends on the time and the period that you are working on. As a freelancer, we are, you know, lord of our time, so it's a bit different that that you are in-house.
Which is the danger of it as well, because if you're in-house, you're forced to have a proper schedule, because you can't really afford not to.
You have to fit into the schedule. The job must be done, so.
Yeah. But yeah, when you're a freelancer, when I was freelancing, my sleeping patterns were just really, really bad. It would just shift every day later and later and later, and then there would be a time where I would just always go to bed when it was getting light outside. And then, it's just such a terrible feeling.
Yeah, I had that last week was so fucked up, and I used to spend a lot of hours, you know, after the job was done, I had to do another work. So I really like sometimes if I'm kind of wasted, but at the weekend I can let myself, you know, just chill out, and it's also very cool to just pull a new energy into next week for yourself. But yeah, the health is very important. So
yeah, exactly. You could ignore it for a while if you're young.
Yeah, you can if you're just, young, but if the problem starts, that's it's not, you know, you are not that hero then.
Exactly.
You know, Jonas, I had a fix for the night creativity thing. Mm-hmm. I figured out it's just because of amount of light that is getting into my room. So I basically covered my windows with blankets, and there you go, night.
Yeah.
At 7 a.m.
Vampire.
Yeah. That looks creepy from outside, but actually it's pretty cozy inside. So, that's the artist's cave.
Yeah.
Yeah, it can help somehow, but it's very common that a lot of artists like to work at night, so something is behind it. So.
It's weird, yeah. I don't know why. Yeah, my mind just starts racing.
Maybe home, and you know that everyone is now sleeping, and you have the peace, and maybe that's it. Yeah. All the life is just... Everyone is in the bed. And
yeah, that's also the thing, right? You're kind of more focused on the stuff you want to do, because there's no phone calls, there's no emails, emails can go into your inbox, because basically you can work for the clients from overseas, but still, it's not that somebody will interrupt you.
Yeah, exactly. So
I kind of understand that, but it's a real trick to actually do it during the day and put it off, and preserve those hours for work, not for...
Yeah, but also if your schedule is not destroyed, you are much more productive for the job, and you probably have much more time for yourself, for your doing the job for yourself only, because if you just sleep, you know, to another day afternoon, it just doesn't make sense.
Yeah, and it really influences the amount of hours you can actually put into it. Like, I feel in my personal experience, the illusion that you can just shift time and have the same hours of creative output, or just output, is not really true. If you actually get up early in the morning and you have like a full day, you tend to actually do a lot more than if you shift that to waking up in the afternoon and then working through the night.
That's what I am also telling to myself. Like, okay, that we have midnight. I have work to do until, I don't know, tomorrow noon. So what do I do? Do I stay up right now and do it until 3 a.m. and die? Or I wake up at, I don't know, 5 a.m. or 6 a.m. and just do the job in probably less time, because I will be, I will get dressed. So I know, I will just go with sleeping.
Yeah, the wake up really just gives you the feeling that the day seems to be longer.
Yeah, exactly.
And if you go very late, if you go to bed very late, it's very soon time that it's getting dark again.
Yeah, it's just daylight. We're really creatures who are built to. Yeah. We really respond to daylight a lot.
Sometimes we are Batman.
Yeah.
There is a cool question in the chat, actually. When you have a partner, right, and that you know, how one can really cope with that kind of a fucked up time schedule of like artists.
That's, I guess they don't.
Yeah.
Pure depression all the time.
Go back to bed. Go back to bed.
What?
Maybe we can ask Betty if how her experience is with this. Do you have a partner maybe, or someone who has to cope with your let's call it effed up time schedule?
My dog.
Your dog's like, what the hell?
You're like, oh my god, I need to go pee, and I usually feel really bad about it, but he's cool with it. I think he learned. But I don't know. I don't recall the last time I slept in a normal time. I think it was like last year.
Last year? Was it 2013? I'm not sure.
I have no idea. But I don't know. I'm not exactly proud of it, but it's something I can't get out of. It becomes a habit after a while.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like a really hard habit to get out of once you're like stuck in it.
Well, it's freelancing, really. I mean, if you get an in-house job, you have to get out of it. There's just no other way.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you're going to be there and look like an absolute zombie when they start at 8
a.m. Yeah, or destroy the relationships between the people that are around you.
I find naps are pretty good as well, just power naps. I like to have a power nap around 3 in the afternoon, yeah, after
above
food.
Above the desk.
Yeah,
because yeah,
20 minutes of waving the head with closed eyes. And
siestas, man. Those Spanish, they knew what was up. It's just the best thing ever.
So, Jonas, you sleep at work, right?
Secretly, yes, but I shouldn't be saying this. I have little power naps, yeah. I just sometimes can't help it. I just doze off in front of my computer. It's when I'm digesting, like an old man, you know. It's like, oh, my stomach is so full.
Yeah,
so all the energy goes to the stomach, and my brain just goes, shuts off.
Or you can still drink bones of Red Bull every day like me.
Yeah, but that's really bad for your health. Like, I've had some times that I doze off, and then I wake up, and my screen's just full of scribbles because my pen is still moving. trying to pretend that I'm still drawing. Like, crappy scribbles all over my... And then I don't have enough undos to fix it, and I have to, like, repaint.
Paint over.
Yeah. Oh, my God. No, they're fucking...
Yes.
What the hell, guys? Another inappropriate thing.
Oh my god, okay. This is just eternalized.
And it has so long. So
some England stories.
Can you just share with us what are you laughing about?
No, I'm going to mute my microphone for a minute. Sorry, guys.
Okay, sure.
What was that about?
I just think somebody at Jonas' place upstairs was doing something loud. So.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh my.
Yeah, but you know, all these level up sessions are so professional and so uptight that we have these things happening. I mean, that's pretty crappy. All right, so you are getting. You are getting into really, really fine details. And, I mean, will you be even able to see them from the, you know, the view, the full view? You said that that whole character is much more bigger, right?
Yeah, it's like, she has like whole body, but it's a pretty big file, so I think it's meant to be looked up close.
Okay. Okay, so you are trying to get one area done, and it's usually the face, and then you move on into another part and do that, and you do that sequential work. You don't work on an overall piece, but on a certain... I mean, when you get to the level after sketching, when you want to establish certain pieces, then you just go one by one and finish them, right?
Yeah, that's why I have like layers for like separate things. I have like a separate layer for face, I have a separate layer for boob, I have a separate layer for helmet, I have a separate layer for like all the other things, because like that's just the way I work.
Yeah.
Yeah. Boob layer.
Yeah, I love the amount of details you put into the face. I mean, in terms of character design and work, it's so crucial to have that personality go through the face. I mean, it's all about the character, and you can tell that the whole story of the character by just painting the face. And it's so, I just love to do that and to express emotion through my characters' faces. And sometimes I'm using it as a supplement to the props and to the design overall to just enforce it, and it's really working fine. And I think it's underestimated in concept art. Like the faces of the character are just really blank sometimes, like they're not even there in that gray kind of an environment. I mean, I try to pretend that there's something that they feel, and yeah, I feel the same with the face you're painting right now.
I actually feel the opposite about, like, maybe because, like, you know, I like the faces so much, that's what I pay attention to when I look at other people's art. But I think most faces I've seen in concept art painted pretty well. The only problem is, like, a lot of people suffer from same face syndrome. Like, if I was to, like, you know, get rid of all their clothing and, like, make all their hair colors the same, they would look all the same. But I think it's just, like, sometimes people just have a habit of drawing the same faces.
Yeah, that's true. That's, like, some kind of a comfort zone that you have to come out of. And yeah, but because sometimes it's all about maybe an overall design, an overall look of the character, not a face. The face can be just a placeholder. So yeah. Okay, let me look up into the questions. Oh, people are just laughing at the whole situation, at the honest. Nice. Nice, you stole the show, man. Are you there? Are they finished? Oh, he's gone. He probably joined them. What the hell?
Wow.
Yeah. Do you make up stories behind your characters while you paint? I mean, I tend to do that.
Sometimes.
Yeah. It's kind of fun. I mean, I tend to start the character, painting a character in the back, and then I came up with, like, oh, so let's say this girl is kind of from that kind of family, the dot, so that's why he carries this talisman or something, and yeah, I just kind of dive into it, and it's, I mean, at that stage, when you're detailing all this stuff, it's pretty, you just tend to do the same thing over and over again. So it's just the fuel for my brain to get this done and, you know, just to tell some story in my head. And sometimes it's enforcing the design. I'm sometimes introducing new elements because of the story I came up with.
Yeah, I think, like, once you have a story behind your character, your character turns out a lot better because, like, you're more enthusiastic about, like, working on your character because, like, you want to bring the character to life based on, like, the story that you think in your head.
Yeah, it's always good. Sometimes the story behind your character is just your brief, right? You have a brief and you have to design the... Sometimes, I mean, I got the briefs that were really, really... complicated, and the briefs, the stories, the bios of the characters came back to, like, the childhoods and stuff, and then you have to design a character from the whole life written in the one file, and then you have to came up with all the elements you have to translate it from to the visuals, and that's the challenge. And I like, even though there's that whole client thing to it, I like to introduce my element that I can stick to, and if I don't like the story, I just change it to mine, but still trying to get it true to the native brief. There's a question in the chat, is that good to have a story behind the character? I think it's good. I think it's even better that, I mean, that's the function of your character, then you're putting it into the context. Of course, your character visually is isolated because it has to show a specific design clearly, just to show, I don't know, 3D artists and props people to know how to build it. But then this character has to work in a specific context, and if you will give that character a context, then it will work in that context, and basically it will look more unified. And like, if you will look at Dan Luvisi's illustrations, I think he is a master of telling the story through the character's outfits, elements. Like, there's tons of stories you can just read by looking at the suit. I'm just talking about Last Man Standing. It's just a whole new level of storytelling that you can introduce by painting certain elements. And it all starts in your head. It's not like it wasn't a happy accident. Dan is just a great storyteller, and that's when it all starts, with an idea, and then he paints a specific things because he thought that this will work here in a specific way. I mean, the Skittles, right? Skittles, and then badass guy with like a black, I'm talking about Gabriel. I mean, that's the great contrast, and it's super funny, and yeah, it comes from life experience. Yeah. Right, Jonas, you there?
Did he die?
Yeah, we're here. Yep.
All right. Guys, sorry for talking that much. I mean, I'm just trying to get some stuff covered from the questions. I would have one thing that I want to mention, and Jonas, would you be able to switch to my screen? I just want to tell just a little bit about the event that was happening, that is happening right now in Poland, and it involves a lot of great, great Polish artists, and I just want to do a quick ad, and then we'll go back to Betty. All right?
It's on your screen, man. Go ahead.
All right. So if you follow me or Dark, probably, or Michał, you have probably seen the photos from the event, which is Polish Digital Art. It's basically an event that is trying to get 30 Polish digital artists' artwork and print it on really nice size and quality canvas that will last for over 150 years in terms of color quality. So it's great quality art prints that are right now a little bit more of a... you can see the work from Maciej, from Marek Okon. They're big names in the whole industry. And there is an ongoing auction that, and you can buy certain pieces for a certain price. You can bid through the internet, and you can pay with Bitcoin and stuff. The starting price is really, really low. Let me actually show you how big all these paintings are. They're really impressive in person, and I would love to let me actually look for a photo that we took with there you go. Okay, this is more funny. The stretch out faces. So you can see these are the size of the paintings. They're really big. Our heads are warped by our good friend Matthias. Thank you, man. And yeah, so there's an ongoing action. I will post the link to the work. I love this piece. I just love this piece. I mean, yeah, it looks awesome in person. So you can the starting price is $150, and I think it's pretty cheap for the quality you're getting and the size of the print and such. So I will post the link. Check it out. There's no restrictions in terms of country you can bid from. So yeah, we even have like 3D printed models. So it's really, really awesome and innovative. This is like the first auction in the world that sells digital art as art. So make sure to check it out. I'll post the link to the chat and event. All right. I think that's it. Sorry for ad interruption.
Cool, man. It was a cool event that we hope that it will not the first time. It was not the first time in, like in, you know, it's everything in Poland. It's like not very, you know, cool working. So it was nice event, and we hope
and
much more. And we are really happy to be part of it. And yeah, we will see how it goes further. So thanks for letting know to people.
Yeah, you know, it's just that we have, like Jonas said, there's not a lot of concept artists from Belgium, right?
Nope.
No, yeah. So that's the thing. We have, actually, Poland is an opposite. I don't know why, but there's plenty of amazing concept artists and illustrators from Poland. And they're, even though you may not know their names because they're not marketing themselves, because they work at Pixar or ILM or stuff like that, but there is a huge Polish community behind the digital and CGI art. So that enabled us to create that kind of an event.
Okay, so Wojtek, I think we can probably wrap up the session soon.
Mm-hmm. Are you just muting your microphone?
Yes.
Okay, there's stuff happening in the background. All right, so just a couple of words to wrap things up. Betty, thank you so much for showcasing your workflow. I think it's just awesome. The level of detail you are aiming to achieve in your art is just, I mean, like you said, sometimes when you just go back, zoom out and look at your work, you feel like it's worth it. And I think it's more than worth it. It's just awesome. I mean, yeah, so thank you so much for devoting these 2 hours to the community and sharing your knowledge with people. And you can go to Facebook and check out Betty's Facebook profile. There's a lot of art there. You can go to her art station. We'll post the links soon so you can check them out on the website. And thank you guys for Overpaints, Darek, Jonas, awesome job. Guys, can you just at least say bye?
Bye
bye.
Bye.
Bye
bye.
Thank you, Betty,
so for joining us. Yeah.
Thank you so much for inviting me.
Yeah, it was awesome. All right, so we will announce our next guest in a couple of hours. Or I think it will be sooner. So is there anything I wanted to talk about? I think there was one thing. No. All right. So see you guys next time. See you next week. If you enjoyed these sessions, please subscribe to the channel and go to the Facebook group. Check it out. Upload your work, critique, comment. And we have set up a website, which is fusrona.com. There's all of the sessions there. There are all of the videos there. There are all overpaints there. So, yeah, see you guys next time. Cheers.
Later, guys. already.